attract men. It's a business. And so we're not talking about somebody who's in a rural area and has a sugar daddy because she's desperate. We're talking about someone who does it to sustain a certain kind of lifestyle. And we'll take your calls. 0891-104-207. Jackie, please help me with that point I made there before we went into the break, right? That if we don't have the discussion on morality, then we're giving young girls the permission to do the same thing.
Well, we live in a society where people are not accountable to anyone or to any system, if I may put it that way. Young people don't live home, they don't go home, they don't report to anybody. Society is not accountable to any constitutional laws, whether we use morality or there's actually laws that regulate prostitution in South Africa. If we may say it's even prostitution, but it's on the lines of prostitution when you're trading yourself for a dollar and a quick buck. So I think we've just gotten to a point where we have become numb in terms of our morals and standards, and social media and the media and the public platforms that distribute this information have made it socially okay for people to do this. And our parents and government is not taking note of where the direction of this lifestyle is going, because as much as we can say it's a person's right to post or sell themselves the way they feel they can do, but then again, are we opening so many problems to social ills that we're not even looking at the systems that would eradicate these ills? And as much as in our country, issues like prostitution is still a criminal offense, but when will we start regulating this activity so that when these things happen, someone is protected and someone is educated within the system? Because, for instance, the girl who's selling herself for 8,000 rand a weekend, let's say it does happen that she goes with this guy and they have a good time and she gets violated. Who protects that act?
Who protects
that person?
Yeah.
No one. But then again, it's easier for us to say, let them play, let them do what they want. But then again, when they come back with those issues, who takes care or who regulates those issues?
Regulation. I don't know, man. It's such a difficult one, because we still haven't dealt with, I don't know if it's a self-esteem issue or if it's, I mean, is that really at the very core of it? Because you said if we don't deal with the core of the problem, we're not getting anywhere. Is it a self-esteem
thing? I don't honestly think that these women have low self-esteem issues, but the mere fact that they're so comfortable exposing themselves in that light and being okay for any judgment come upon them. Because when you post a nude or you post a breast or a bum, you must be extremely confident to say, well, this is me and this is what I'm offering and this is how much it is. So I don't think it's self-esteem. It might be self-worth or self-esteem, but those girls are on a power trip. And it's one thing to understand their behavior and also understand their state of mentality.
Guys, you're blowing my mind tonight. I don't you really are taking calls. 0891-104-207. Okay, so
I like that comment.
That you're blowing my mind.
No, yeah, that too. But I like the comment that, you know, it actually is an issue of self worth, because the reality is, and I've said this so many times, that if women could learn to start making, being more financially powerful for themselves.
Yeah.
You know, where a woman starts knowing how easy it is to earn the 10,000 rands that she's having to sell her body for. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The moment that women are given that kind of power, then they'll realize that 10,000 is actually nothing. Because for these guys, I mean, you know, if somebody's is taking 10 grand out of a bank account that has a million rand in it.
It's nothing. Yeah.
It's nothing to him. So similarly, if this woman had a million rand in her bank account, she would laugh at a guy that says, I'd like to sleep with you for 10,000 rand.
Yeah. Yeah, very good point. Yeah.
So it, 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 it really does actually boil down to, in as much as we sit there and we think, okay, these ladies are being greedy and they just want these lives that they can't actually afford. Mm-hmm. The reality is, if they were more empowered, if they had tools to actually make this money for themselves without having to resort to selling their bodies, mm. then we'd probably be addressing the situation at its core.
Yeah.
I mean, if you ask Jackie how many times she's had people say to her, so how do I get into this lifestyle? Because she writes about it in her book.
Yeah.
And they're all curious. And I can tell you now, it's not just girls that are, you know, in varsity or girls that are struggling or girls that are... There's a lot of women in there that you would ordinarily look at and think, this woman has a job. She's, you know, she's doing fairly yeah. well in life. She wants more.
I'll be honest with you. This is the honest truth. That even I, in this... at this juncture in my life, have sat in with a woman and listened to that conversation. I have not participated. I am very, very moral. But I have listened to a woman ask another one, doesn't your guy have a friend, you know?
Exactly. But, I get a lot of that. I mean, women who are already empowered. It's yeah. not women who can need jobs or anything like that. I mean, I get women who call me on a regular basis to say, how do I get into the hockey club? How do I look a rich guy? How do I get a car out of the man, you know? And it's not women who are in dire situations. It's just women who just want to experiment, and now they feel that because so-and-so, my friend drives in the city Benz, I also want to drive in the city Benz, so I'm going to find the easiest way to do it. And some women in marriages are bored of marriages. They want to experiment new things, so they start doing this crazy, crazy things where they start luring other men so that there's some kind of activity in their lives. And I promise you, I had a woman who called me like last night. And I'm like, I'm in Cape Town, I'm coming back. She's like, no, I'm desperate to speak to you. I'm like, what's the issue? She said to me, my husband is sleeping with my friend, but I am okay with it because I'm also sleeping with my boss. And my boss, yeah, and my boss just gave me a promotion and a new car. But the thing is, I cannot tell my husband about the promotion because he had already suspected that we are cheating already. So, but because I had already been doing these things alongside, I'm even afraid to tell him that the current house that we're living in belongs to my boss.
Oh,
and I said, he's scared that her husband is going to find out that the title deed is not really there because he has been facing a lot of things in between. But now the boss wants a serious relationship, and he's forcing her to tell her husband that actually the house that you're living in, ever since he got married last year, June, it's actually my boss's house.
So
her greed and lust and desire led her to this mess of a life. I'm talking about a 38-year-old woman, not a 12-year-old or 20-year-old. 38 years old, and the husband is 45.
Mm-hmm.
So imagine what's going to happen to his ego when he finds out that his wife is sleeping with the boss and the boss owns the house.
Mm. Okay, let's take calls. Wowza. Justin. Wow. Abdullah's on the line in Peter Marsburg. Abdullah, good evening.
Good. And how are you?
Good. How are you, my brother?
Okay. Remember, basically, what we did as you and me, we restricted God to the church, the mosque. We never introduced basically our living. We our daily living, we left God out. Mm. We say, God, you don't belong in a workplace. You don't belong in my social life. You don't belong in all those places. You belong to the church. When I want to repent, when I want to for some forgiveness, I go to the church, I'll find you there. But God supposed to be play a part in our life.
Mm.
That's our biggest problem. Today we have left God totally out. Take for example, before it was a crime if a husband cheated on his wife.
Mm.
Today it's not a crime.
Yeah, he feels better on Sunday after going to church. He feels better about what he continuously does.
Yeah, you see, another thing is, a lady now, she cannot charge her husband to if he had an affair with somebody else, it's not a crime in the South African law anymore. Basically, South African law will tell him that you need to look after your own relationship.
Yeah.
Why you never look after your relationship?
Not our problem.
All our laws are moved away from God. And when we move away from God, then we will have all the situations in the world.
Yeah, well, this is essentially what Jackie said earlier, that there is, why? Who do I account to? Who says I must account? There's nobody that I must account to. I do what I want. Abdullah, let's leave it there. Thank you so much for calling. Crystal in Matadiele. Crystal, good evening.
Hey, good evening, Nadege. How are you?
I'm well, Ndate. How are you?
No, I'm fine, yeah. No, man, you know, that is very interesting, the discussion, because these people, they are not even special people calling themselves medicated. Even, you can see, man, these young girls or ladies, even from universities, you know, I have many friends that I now no longer from first year when I was still there until now. They have turned into some glamorous thing that they always post pictures on the beach, go to Cape Town somewhere. You're right, this person I was with them a few years back. But now, Naledi, is the fact that there's nothing wrong these days. You cannot tell a person this is a not okay, not whatever. And I'm glad when you mentioned the issue of morality, because it's important that you guys talk about morality. It's very important, the issue of morality. You must mention it and emphasize it, that it can't be correct that you want young people busy enjoying things that are very temporary and they are not going to take them anywhere. So like, I was there when you were talking about the issue of morality. Otherwise, Ella,
Can I quickly jump in?
I just want to ask a question. So what about the boys who sleep with men? What about the guys who are also sleeping, who sleep with men so that they get apartments, cars, tenders, businesses? What about them? They also sleep the most with this life, because it's not just girls, you know. You've got men who sleep with younger boys, who sleep with anything that comes, really. But younger boys also do it. I don't even mean 20-year-old. I mean 30-35-year-old men sleeping with 50-60-year-old men, you know, to get tenders and cars and fancy Gucci bags, as well as trips as well. It's not just like girls are the only ones doing it. We see it all over Instagram, where a certain minister is befriending a certain guy, but you would see the age group or even the relation that doesn't even correlate. But now they're the best of friends on social media.
And the fascinating thing is that it quite often that guy, that younger guy, wouldn't identify as gay publicly.
Exactly.
Yeah. No.
Hey, okay.
Exactly.
Yeah. Wow.
Okay, guys, let's seriously, man, slow down. N sends an SMS, she says, in Josie, I have this view that if all men cheat, then why not get cheated on by someone that will take care of you financially? So I admire slay queens. Shah. Andres in the Free State says, I like that though it's a heavy I like that though it's a heavy price. I don't know what that means, but at least 100 rand per session as quick as possible, as long as no one knocks the other one, no strings attached, because I'm taken. What on earth? Kay in Bloemfontein says, there are high-profile politicians who sleep with young straight men just to so-called harvest power. What, harvest power?
What?
Yeah.
Hi guys, Anonymous is in Mpumalanga. Anonymous, good evening.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm good, thanks. This has happened to me a lot of times.
Okay.
It's not only happening on Instagram, but it's happening even on Facebook. It's really scary that these old men would eat flashy cars, will even go and park outside of the secondary school in Mpumalanga. So when kids come out there, they just want to go in there. They just want money. They just want everything. So I think we just have to go back to our communities as adults and start this youth service that we can just teach these ladies that they don't need to sleep with any men to look all flashy. Can we just all go to school and earn our hard money? Because it's not helping.
But Anonymous, you said you've had this happen to you a few times. What does that mean? You've had these transactions.
I've had guys.
Yeah.
Yes. I'll post an innocent pictures, and I'll have a lot of guys DMing me saying that, hey, I'm going to Cape Town for a week, and may you please accompany me for like 5,000.
Did you say yes?
And I can also add up on 5,000 if we're not even gonna use a condom.
Oh,
of which is wrong. Yes.
Have you said yes?
No. I can never sell my soul like that. It's scary.
Yo, Anonymous, thanks for sharing that. You know what scares me, Linda, is this thing of no condoms. But listen, if we do it for 10,000 rand a weekend, I can push it up to 20 if we don't use a condom.
And the problem with that is next week he's doing the same thing with another one. Next week you are being offered 20,000 by another one. So all of a sudden, it's not as if the 20,000 is gonna wash away. Miraculously wash away the pirates or anything like that. It won't.
Jackie,
is
please.
Ever worth it?
Is it really? But ask somebody who says, but 20,000 rand looks pretty good, would look pretty good. That's the problem, you see. Jackie, can we talk about the condoms? Because here's the fact of the matter, is that you can call me, Jackie, and say, Naledi, come down to Cape Town, I'm going to give you 20,000 rand for a weekend. And when I'm there, you are completely in power, Jackie. You are in power. I can't go anywhere. And if you say, hey, no condom, what is it that I can do?
The thing is, with this kind of agreement or arrangement, is that the person who has the money is actually the one in power. The minute I say, yes, I'm hopping onto a flight, automatically, as soon as I get into the flight, I lose my power.
Mm.
Because immediately when I land on the other side, he controls everything.
Mm.
My movement, where I sleep, where I eat, what time I go, what time I wake up, how I expect.
Mm.
And remember, you're in a remote place. You probably don't even have funds to fund your own flight back.
Mm.
For instance, remember, you're in Mauritius. So how are you going to get back if somebody doesn't fund that train to get back? So even if he doesn't give you the money that you guys agreed on to top up the agreement,
you can't do anything.
You can't negotiate. There's no room to negotiate. Because if he says, listen, you're already here. You know, we had one or two wines, bottle of the wines, and we're going to use a condom first round, and in between it pops, and then he rips it open and then he continues. The minute you try to say no, he will force you into a corner. And you will lose all sense of morality, all sense of value at the time to say, okay, fine, I'm in the situation, but now I have to suppress my values because now I'm in this horrific situation that I cannot get out of. I'm in Mauritius. Who's going to take me back home?
Mm.
So automatically, you will sleep with that person in the hopes that in the morning you will drink a pill or something. Or you'll just hope and pray he doesn't have any kind of disease or STD. Which is what young girls do anyway, you know. As soon as they see extra cash money on the table, they forget. Like, they just completely wear it off and say, oh, well, we'll see in the morning. I'll sort it out. Let's just hope nothing happens. He looks clean. I don't see anything on his penis, so maybe he's okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they just look at it visually and say, it's okay. But they don't know, you know. So I believe as soon as you leave wherever you are and you step into their space, you have lost control already.
Yeah.
So there's not much you can do.
Oh, I hope you've given
something
to think about. Yeah, Linda?
What else is said about this is, you know, the whole issue of, once again, somebody sitting there and thinking, well, I've had unprotected sex with people from down the road, and I wasn't getting paid for it anyway.
Mm.
That then, once again, brings in that element of, you know, I might as well get paid.
Might as well get paid. You know
it
what else I've heard? I've heard people say, Even if people don't die from HIV or AIDS anymore, I'll just take the pill, I'll be okay.
Yes, you'll take the pill. You'll get on the treatment. Nobody dies anymore. That's it. That's what people say. And it's such a sad thing, because the worst thing that you could ever do to yourself is getting constant reinfections, which is inevitable in this sort of situation. Because the moment you find out you're HIV positive, then you go, well, I'll throw all caution to the wind now.
Yeah, because I'm already...
What's the point? I'm already positive. And
that's
reinfection. You get different strains. You get... It'll just take you very quickly.
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead, Jackie.
But I was saying, Linda, I do agree with you completely. And I just wanted to also highlight a certain part in this whole notion. Because other girls who are already infected are passing it on purposefully.
Yeah.
Because of either they got raped, or they slept with somebody who's older who never took care of them afterwards, or they were promised marriages and it didn't happen, now they got infected. And now they're just spreading it, knowing very well that they are infected.
So I'll agree to that
10,000 rand, and maybe also negotiate another higher rate for sleeping without a condom.
Yay.
But while they know their status and they know their intention or their agenda in doing whatever they're doing. So that's why it's easier for them just to say, oh well, pay me anyway, because I'm still going to sleep with you without a condom, whether you ask me or not. Because I look hot and you like me and
you're not going to say no. Yeah.
You're not going to say no. And men just like, oh, okay, cool. She's young, she's hot, and she's like a proper yellow bone, basically, and she's going to be okay. They spread it like that all the time. I mean, I had about 12 girls that I spoke to last year at UJ who all were infected and they were passing it on purposefully. And to all the men who are married, saying, oh, well, they've destroyed my life, so therefore I'm going to just do this anyway. So you get a man sleeping with a girl and passing it to the wife, and then the wife, I don't know where the wife goes, but the man will probably go to another younger girl, and then it just becomes
spicy. Terrible. You know, guys, we need to wrap this up. Jackie, how do we get our hands on the book?
The book is available at exclusivebooks and tickleup.com and bargainbooks and on my website, jackiepamuze.com.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us, Jackie Pamuze, the author of Bear, The Blesses Game. Wow, that was enlightening. Linda, thank you, brother. Two books under your resume now.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. And yeah, both are available directly from me. I'm on social media. I'm literally on every single social media you can think of.
Yeah.
I'm on Instagram. I'm on Twitter. I'm not a slay king. And my handle is at Linda Yende on all of them. And I'm on Facebook as Linda Yende.
Oh, my brother, thank you so much. You're a superstar.
Always a pleasure. Thanks.
So, Dear Uncle L and Wake Up Woman, Linda Andayende.